وهل أتاك حديث موسى إذ رأى نارا فقال لأهلهم كثوا إني آنست نارا لعلي آتيكم منها بقبس أو أجد على النار هدى.
بسم الله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وبعد. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إني أنا ربك فاخلع نعليك إنك بالوادي المقدس طوى وأنا اخترتك فاستمع لما يوحى إنني أنا الله لا إله إلا أنا فاعبدني وأقم الصلاة لذكري. صدق الله العظيم. We had concluded the previous segment on a very, very sensitive and emotional note and moment, and that was the grand moment where Sayyidina Musa عليه الصلاة والسلام was crowned with the lofty station of prophethood. وَهَلْ فَوْقَ ذَلِكَ كَرَامَةٌ وَهَلْ فَوْقَ ذَلِكَ كَرَامَةٌ أَبَدًا أَبَدًا. Sheikh Abu al-Hasan Ali Nadwi rahimahullah writes in the famous book Qasasu al-Nabiyyin, which we teach our children and beginners learn in Arabic, regarding the Prophet Salih alayhi salatu wassalam, كان صالح ولدا نجيبا, that he was an upright boy, he was a dignified boy, and people seen a future for him. سَيَكُونُ لَهُ شَأْنٌ سَيَكُونُ لَهُ شَأْنٌ. There's a definite future for him, there's a prosperous future for him. But people interpreted his future as wealth, affluence, and people around him, and he will be riding one of the most fine conveyances. وَكَمْ يَكُونُ سُرُورُهُ يَوْمَئِذٍ. And what would be the joy of Salih on that day, or the joy of his family on that day, when he will come out and people will honor, respect, revere and salute him, and they will say that this is the son of so-and-so, so-and-so. وَأَرَادَ اللَّهُ أَن يُشَرِّفَهُ بِالنُّبُوَّةِ. And then Shaykh Abu al-Hasan Ali Nadwi rahimahullah writes, but Allah decided to privilege and crown and honor him with prophethood. وَهَلْ فَوْقَ ذَلِكَ كَرَامَةً وَهَلْ فَوْقَ ذَلِكَ كَرَامَةً. And then he asked the question, can there be a greater honor? Can there be a greater privilege? You go to an inauguration ceremony. Someone has been, you know what, sworn into office, someone has graduated, someone has been inaugurated. These are different titles, etc. But can you imagine the lofty position that Allah has selected someone for prophethood? Surely there can be no greater honor than that. So Allah said to Musa alayhi salatu wassalam, Inni ana rabbuk, surely I am your Lord. Allahu Akbar. Fakhla'na alayk, remove your shoes. Tawadu'an, idharan lil adab, as a gesture of humility, as a mark of respect. Our deen is brimming with adab. Our deen is brimming with adab. The more adab a person has, the greater the acquisition, the more the merit. إِنَّكَ بِالْوَادِ الْمُقَدَّسِ طُوَى. Surely you are in the blessed plain of Tuwa. So today, geographically, this mount, which is referred to as Jabal Munajat. And remember, subsequent to this visit of Musa alayhi salam coming to Mount Sinai, which is approximately 500 odd kilometers from Cairo. And alhamdulillah, I say this in gratitude to the Almighty, years back I had the privilege of traveling. It's desert terrain, it's hot. We drove 5 long hours from Cairo. People go to Egypt, you go to the pyramids, the Ahram, and I had the opportunity of visiting the pyramids as well. And as the discussion will come of the River Nile, in which Sayyidina Musa alayhi salatu wassalam was placed as a baby in the basket, we went for a little cruise on the River Nile as well. And I also had the opportunity of traveling, alhamdulillah, from Cairo for a good 5 hours in desert to get there, to visit the precise location and to ascend this mountain. And my word, it was an amazing experience. Amazing, you know, it was unique. There was a combination of factors. The next day we were traveling to New York and there was lectures that were taking place, etc. So it was quite a busy schedule in many fronts. But just to speak about this entire visit to the mountain itself, Jabal Munajat, Allah also speaks about the fact that the olive tree grows in this region. وَشَجَرَةً تَخْرُجُ مِن طُورِ سَيْنَاءَ تَنْبُتُ بِالدُّهْنِ وَصِبْغٍ لِلْآكِلِينَ. In the 18th juz in Surah Mu'minun, Allah speaks, وَشَجَرَةً and the tree, تَخْرُجُ مِن طُورِ سَيْنَاءَ, which grows on Mount Sinai, تَنْبُتُ بِالدُّهْنِ, in which there is this amazing oil, تَنْبُتُ بِالدُّهْنِ وَصِبْغٍ لِلْآكِلِينَ, and it can become like a type of a gravy for those who eat it. Remember, the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam would take bread and dip it in vinegar, and he said, نِعْمَ الْإِدَامُ الْخَلُّ, نِعْمَ الْإِدَامُ الْخَلُّ. Today, medical science tells us on the benefits and the properties of apple cider vinegar, and you have motherly enzymes in it, and the natural and the organic, etc. The Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam would dip bread in it, and he said, what a great gravy it is. So Allah speaks about olive oil and the olive trees that grow on Mount Sinai. So anyway, we arrived there, and this entire location is called Jabal Munajat. Munajat meaning where, you know, you converse and communicate. You have these du'as, munajat maqbool, etc. We had the opportunity to climb the mountain on camelback, till we reached the zenith of the mountain, And this entire place is called Munajat. And this is where Sayyidina Musa alayhi salatu wasalam got to converse and communicate with Allah. In fact, I just, you know, recall our personal experience and incident that when we kind of got to the top, it started raining quite heavy. It was raining buckets. And we were then rescued by some people living in a cave in the mountain, who took us in, gave us some shelter, offered us some basic hospitality, etc. And then obviously we engaged in prayer and dua, because Allah refers to this land and this valley and this location as Muqaddas, blessed, right? This is where communication took place. Any location on which nobility, virtue takes place has great reward. There was a good friend of mine in California, where I had spent 3 Ramadans years back, and I was a guest at his house. And subhanAllah, there was something about him that he mentioned which was very amazing. When I was leaving after the one particular Ramadan, he had put the house on the market, and he said that, I'm hoping that this house can be purchased by a Muslim, and ideally from a Muslim, a person who has memorized the Quran. And honestly, if I find a Muslim who has memorized the Quran, even if he offers me something less in value, I will still pass the house on to him. And I said, subhanAllah, that's quite a unique preference and a unique desire. Any reason to this? So he then teared and he said, my 3 children memorized the Quran in this lounge of mine. And you are here visiting and you reciting Quran. And I cannot imagine that this blessed location in which Quran was recited for so many years by so many people, after a period of time, unfortunately, it becomes dormant and inactive, and anything and everything besides Quran takes place. And I teared because this was such an amazing thing, that subhanAllah, that the preservation or the passion to preserve the richness of the location. We are of the Salafus Salihin, they would say, at this location in my house, I had completed the Quran X hundreds of times, 500 khatams I had made on this place. So Allah refers to this valley of Tuwa as Muqaddas, as blessed, as sacred. And subsequent to this meeting of Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam, then he came to Mount Tur on many instances. When he received the Torah, he came to Mount Tur. Even prior to that, there were other visits of Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam to Mount Tur. وَوَاعَدْنَا مُوسَى 30 لَيْلَةً وَأَتْمَمْنَاهَا بِعَشْرٍ فَتَمَّ مِيقَاتٍ. And we promised Musa alayhi salam and made an agreement with him to come, and he made i'tikaf at Mount Tur for 30 days, and then it was extended, and Sayyidina Musa alayhi salatu wasalam spent 40 days at Mount Tur. So the Mount Tur and the location features then continuously in the life of Musa alayhi salam. It was an amazing experience for us. memorable, indelible, rich, profound, and I have a vivid recollection of it, though many years had passed. And I would strongly recommend you that if you are in the region, it's a must visit. Of course, it's a desert terrain, it's a long drive, but remember, you've seen this Jabal Munajat, the location where Sayyidina Musa alayhi salatu wasalam was blessed with revelation. That takes us into the next verse, and that is the 13th verse of Surah Taha. Allah says to Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam, وَأَنَا اخْتَرْتُكَ فَاسْتَمِعْ لِمَا يُوحَى وَأَنَا اخْتَرْتُكَ فَاسْتَمِعْ لِمَا يُوحَى. And O Musa, I have selected you. I have selected you. Selected you for what? In another verse, I have selected you بِرِسَالَاتِي وَبِكَلَامِي. بِرِسَالَاتِي وَبِكَلَامِي. I have selected you for my prophethood. I have selected you to be the deputy, to be the vicegerent, to be the representative. This is the favor of the Almighty upon any individual, that He selects that individual. وَأَنَا اخْتَرْتُكَ, and I have selected you. فَاسْتَمِعْ لِمَا يُوحَى. So listen to the revelation that follows. So basic Arabic grammar will reveal to you that istama'a yastami'u istima'. One is sami'a yasma'u and one is istama'a yastami'u. So istama'a means listen attentively with absolute mind, heart, and be totally focused. And this is revelation. And we know Imam Bukhari commences his authentic compilation on the chapter of revelation, because that is the greatest boon of the Almighty on the human race, that there is this revelation, which is a guidance, which is an inspiration. So the agency of prophets and the revelation is the greatest favor of the Almighty upon mankind. And hence the famous narration of Umm Ayman radiallahu anha, post the demise of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that she cried and she said that at the demise of any prophet prior to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, there was consolation that it would be followed by another prophet and the continuation of revelation. But post the demise of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, now prophethood has been sealed and has been concluded, and there is no prophet to come, and hence there is no revelation beyond and post the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَأَنَا اخْتَرْتُكَ, and I have selected you. فَاسْتَمِعْ, so listen attentively. لِمَا يُوحَى, لِمَا يُوحَى, to that which follows, the revelation that comes through, to that which has been revealed. And that takes us into the next verse, and that is the 14th verse. And this is now the revelation that comes upon Sayyidina Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. إِنَّنِي أَنَا اللَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنَا فَاعْبُدْنِي. إِنَّنِي أَنَا اللَّهُ, verily I am Allah, verily I am Allah. There's no words that can possibly encapsulate the richness of this moment. There's just no words. This is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala communicating with Sayyidina Musa alayhi salatu wasalam directly, and him being endowed, favored, blessed with prophethood. إِنَّنِي أَنَا اللَّهُ. And the scholars say that Allah had given him the absolute conviction and certainty that he knew this was divine, and this was absolute, and this was real, and this was authentic. Because remember, the devil can come and do a lot of whispers to people. There are many tales of the devil impersonating people and making whispers that you are very pious and you are exempted, and you know, you don't have to. This is all devilish. This is all devilish. This is all devilish whispers, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the noblest of the entire creation of Allah, and he was not exempt from any commandments of the Almighty. All the laws of the Sharia applied to him, applied to him. An-takalif, the laws of Sharia, la yasqut anil muntahil kamil. It no human, regardless of his lofty rank, will be exempt to say, no, because of your lofty rank, prayer is not mandatory for you. Because of your lofty rank, you exempt from this. That is a fallacy, that's a myth, that's a devilish whisper. So obviously, this was divine, this was authentic, this was from the Almighty, and hence the Prophet Musa alayhi salatu wasalam had that inner comfort, peace, and conviction. Innani ana Allah, verily I am Allah. La ilaha illa ana, there is no being, no deity, no ism, no sovereign being but me. Fa'budni, fa'budni, worship me, worship me. وَأَقِمِ الصَّلَاةَ لِذِكْرِي and establish prayer for my remembrance. My brother, my sister, pause, halt, reflect for a moment. Barely the introduction of prophethood has happened. Allah has, and that's why we spoke in the first segment that the theme of this particular surah in general is Tawheed, Risalat, and Ma'ad. Tawheed, monotheism, the oneness of the Almighty, the oneness of the Almighty. I was reading in one tafsir now, like Surah Mujadala, La takhlu ayatum min ayatiha. There isn't a verse in Surah Mujadala, but in it is the mention of the name of Allah. So this is one of the specialities of Surah Mujadala. قَدْ سَمِعَ اللَّهُ قَوْلَ الَّتِي تُجَادِلُكَ فِي زَوْجِهَا. In every verse of this chapter, the word Allah has been mentioned. So one of the themes of this chapter is Tawheed, the oneness of the Almighty. Risala, the prophethood. Just as Musa alayhi salam was a prophet, he received the revelation. This is then, extended to the people of Makkah to understand that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam is a prophet of Allah, and he received revelation. And of course, Ma'ad, that is preparation for the life to come. So Allah addressing Musa alayhi salatu wasalam says, Wa aqimi salata li dhikri, and establish prayer for my remembrance. This makes us understand the importance of prayer. So prayer, salah, in principle, featured in the shara'i'u man qablana, the nations that preceded us. Of course, there was variation in the format, in the units, in the presentation, in the recitation, in the gesture, in the bowing, etc. In fact, bowing, right, is a speciality of the prayer of this ummah. In the previous ummah, there was qiyam, there was prostration, there was no bowing. And this is mentioned in many, many tafasir. And that is why Allah says in the first juz, in the second chapter in Surah Baqarah, that وَلَا تَكُونُوا أَوَّلَ كَافِرٍ بِهِ وَلَا تَشْتَرُوا بِآيَاتِي ثَمَنًا قَلِيلًا وَإِيَّايَ فَاتَّقُونَ وَلَا تَلْبِسُوا الْحَقَّ بِالْبَاطِلِ وَتَكْتُمُوا الْحَقَّ وَأَنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ وَأَقِيمُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَآتُوا الزَّكَاةَ وَارْكَعُوا مَعَ الرَّاكِعِينَ وَأَقِيمُوا الصَّلَاةَ. And here, if you look at the context, the address is to Bani Israel. Bani Israel, in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, those that continued and the generations that followed thereafter. Wa aqimu salah, establish prayer. Wa atu zakah, discharge zakah. Warka'u ma'ar raki'een, and bow with those that bow. There are two explanations given to this here. Either it means perform prayer in congregation. Perform prayer in congregation. Or the other meaning to it is that perform the salah as the teachings of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in which now ruku has been included. So in principle, prayer was found even in the time of Sayyidina Musa alayhi salatu wassalam, like Allah speaks about it in the 11th juz as well in Surah Yunus. فَمَا آمَنَ لِمُوسَى إِلَّا ذُرِّيَّةٌ مِّنْ قَوْمِهِ عَلَىٰ خَوْفٍ مِّنْ فِرْعَوْنَ وَمَلَئِهِمْ أَنْ يَفْتِنَهُمْ وَإِنَّ فِرْعَوْنَ لَعَالٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَإِنَّهُ لَمِنَ الْمُسْرِفِينَ وَقَالَ مُوسَى يَا قَوْمِ إِن كُنْتُمْ آمَنْتُمْ بِاللَّهِ فَعَلَيْهِ تَوَكَّلُوا إِن كُنْتُمْ مُسْلِمِينَ فَقَالُوا عَلَى اللَّهِ اجعلوا بيوتكم قبلة وأقيموا الصلاة. اجعلوا بيوتكم قبلة. Make your homes a قبلة وأقيموا الصلاة and establish prayer. We need to remind ourselves. Just the other day I was in the masjid and I was happy to see a young man come to the masjid and offer prayer, which was great, which was amazing, which was wonderful, which was noble. Not that I consciously took out time to look, but because he was performing prayer just adjacent to me. But the swift manner in which he was performing prayer, and how haphazard and quickly he was going through the motions, was quite painful. Salah is something that we need to take pride in it. The famous hadith, the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Salli fa innaka lam tusalli." Repeat your prayer because you have not offered prayer. And the person repeated the prayer. And the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Repeat your prayer because you have not prayed." And this is the scholars and the jurists tell us, because of the absence of ta'dil arkan, amongst other things, that there were not adequate pauses between the gestures of salah. So we need to take pride in enhancing and up in the nature of our prayer to make it a superior type of prayer. جُعِلَتْ قُرَّةُ عَيْنِي فِي الصَّلَاةِ. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the coolness of my eyes is in prayer. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would perform lengthy units of prayer. وَأَقِمِ الصَّلَاةِ, and establish prayer لِذِكْرِ. You know, Allama Iqbal said, تیرا سجدہ کہیں کافر نہ کر دے تجھ کو اے اقبال, تو جھکتا کہیں اور ہے اور سوچتا کہیں اور ہے. Let it not be that your superficial prostration renders you an apostate, because you claim to prostrate before the Almighty while your thoughts wander elsewhere. Wow, that's such a deep message. Let it not be, O Iqbal, the poet addressing himself, tera sajda kahi kafir na kar de tujhko e Iqbal, tu jhukta kahi aur hai, sochta kahi aur hai. That you saying, you bowing and prostrating to the Almighty, you dropping your head down in sujood to Him, which is, of course, أَقْرَبُ مَا يَكُونُ الْعَبْدُ, the closest a servant can be to his Creator is when he's in prostration. Allah rebukes Abu Jahl in Surah Alaq, that Allah says that كَلَّا إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَيَطْغَى أَرْرَآهُ اسْتَغْنَى إِنَّ إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ الرُّجْعَى أَرَأَيْتَ الَّذِي يَنْهَى عَبْدًا إِذَا صَلَّى أَرَأَيْتَ الَّذِي يَنْهَى عَبْدًا إِذَا صَلَّى. Have you seen the one who prohibits a servant? And that's the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam from performing prayer. So he doesn't bow, he doesn't prostrate, and he wants to block and bar and prevent the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam from offering prayer. And on one particular instance, he actually made physical advancement to assault the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, but between him and the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam there was a trench and there was flames, and when he seen this, he withdrew. So people asked him, what's the reason, why did you withdraw when you were going towards the Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam? And he said, I seen flames of fire. And that's why Allah concludes the chapter by saying, فَلْيَدْعُ نَادِيَهُ سَنَدْعُ الزَّبَانِيَهُ فَلْيَدْعُ نَادِيَهُ. Tell him to call his group and his cronies. We dispatching the angels of hell. So prayer is of absolute importance. Let it not be that you prostrating and your thoughts are roaming elsewhere. That moment which ought to be the highlight of your prayer. Because why? The most dignified organ of the human body is the face, and you drop in that in prostration, and that is your absolute point of humility. And at that time, your thoughts ought to be focused on the Almighty and on prayer. وَأَقِمِ الصَّلَاةِ, and establish prayer لِذِكْرِ. And then that takes us into the next verse, and this is still part of the munajat and the communication and the wahi that is coming upon the Prophet Musa alayhi salatu wassalam. Inna sa'ata atiya akadu ukhfiha litujza kullu nafsin bima tas'a. Allah says to Musa alayhi salatu wassalam, verily as-sa'a, the hour, meaning qiyamah, atiyatun, will come, will arrive, is inevitable. Qiyamah is an absolute reality. Akadu ukhfiha, akadu ukhfiha. So now, kada yakadu means close, near. Akhfa yukhfi, ikhfa means to hide, to conceal. Akadu ukhfiha, I will conceal it. Many scholars say that ya kada yakadu is in the meaning of arada yuridu. أَكَادُ أُخْفِيهَا أُرِيدُ إِخْفَاءَهَا. Qiyamah is a reality, but I have intended to conceal its precise time and moment. So this is the wisdom of Allah in the hadith of Jibreel, when Jibreel alayhi salam came, أَتَاكُمْ يُعَلِّمُكُمْ دِينَكُمْ, when the sahaba said, فَعَجِبْنَا لَهُ يَسْأَلُهُ وَيُصَدِّقُهُ. This was very strange. A person came, he was attired in white, لَا يُرَى عَلَيْهِ أَثَرُ السَّفَرُ وَلَا يَعْرِفُهُ مِنَّا أَحَدٍ. He was clad in white, yet nobody knew him. There was no trace of journey, but he wasn't one of the residents of Mecca. So we didn't know him. He didn't, like, he wasn't a known person to us. Yet, he didn't look like he traveled and came. So clad in white, attired in white, and he came and he's asking questions and he's replying. So asking is a sign he doesn't know, and affirming is a sign he knows. فَعَجِبْنَا لَهُ يَسْأَلُهُ وَيُصَدِّقُهُ. Long story short, in the hadith of Jibreel, that when the question was asked to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, مَتَ السَّاعَةِ, when is Qiyamah? The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَا الْمَسْؤُولُ عَنْهَا بِأَعْلَمَ مِنَ السَّائِلِ, that the person asking and the person being asked, neither of them know the answer. Neither of them know. يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ السَّاعَةِ, يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ السَّاعَةِ أَيَّانَ مُرْسَاهَا, يَسْأَلُونَكَ كَأَنَّكَ حَفِيٌّ عَنْهَا, they ask you as though you know the precise time. No, this is in the knowledge of Allah. أَكَادُ أُخْفِيهَا. And to be honest, my brother and sister, that Allah has not told us of the precise time of our death, and Allah has not told us of the precise hour of Qiyamah, which ought to keep us on guard, vigilant, wary, active, focused at all times. Yet, unfortunately, we're so heedless, oblivious, negligent, and unmindful. Imagine if we knew when we will die and we knew when Qiyamah will come, there will be no limit to the disobedience, the shenanigans, the violation, and the mischief that man will make on earth. Because, well, I've got 30 years still, I've got 40 years still, there's so many centuries left for Qiyamah or whatever, right? Because nowadays people kind of predict the apocalypse. People predict the apocalypse, and that's a chapter of its own. Because we know that the precise time of the apocalypse or the end of this world or the happening of Qiyamah is only known to the Almighty. So this is in the wisdom of the Almighty, so that we remain prepared, or we try and keep ourselves prepared. أَكَادُ أُخْفِيهَا, I have intended concealing it. So nobody knows the exact time, only Allah knows. Why will Qiyamah come? What is the illah? What is the reason? لِتُجْزَى كُلُّ نَفْسٍ بِمَا تَسْعَى. So that every soul, li, illah, so that every soul, tujza, can be compensated, can be retributed, bima tas'a, for that which it toils and endeavors. So Qiyamah is a day, and so Musa alayhi salam is reminded, or he's informed, or he's told about Qiyamah, about prayer, about worshiping Allah, etc. We spoke about the fact that prayer featured in all the previous religions as well, but in our Sharia, it has a unique combination of so many different aspects to it. It has prayer, then it has Salah, it has Quran recitation, which is, you know, enhances it on a different level. Then Allah told Musa alayhi salam that Qiyamah is inevitable. Man mata faqad qamat qiyamatuhu, the one who dies, his Qiyamah has occurred, has commenced, has happened. Why will Qiyamah happen? لِتُجْزَى كُلُّ نَفْسٍ بِمَا تَسْعَى, so that every soul can be compensated. And this is a logical proof, because there's so many people that are abusing, exploiting, and so many people are victims. Does it mean the world will just continue like this, that some will abuse and some will receive? Surely there has to be a day where all these differences are meted out and are addressed, and the tyrant is taken to task and the victim is compensated. Well, this is the day, لِتُجْزَى كُلُّ نَفْسٍ بِمَا تَسْعَى. Qiyamah is going to come and every person will be compensated. Allah uses the expression, وَوُفِّيَتْ كُلُّ نَفْسٍ, وَوُفِّيَتْ كُلُّ نَفْسٍ بِمَا عَمِلَتْ, and every soul will be rewarded in full. Remember, my brother, in this world, nobody can compensate you in full, nor can retribution take place in full. Sometimes a person has claimed the lives of 50. You say he has 50 life sentences, but he only has a single life. He only has a single life. It compounds, it exacerbates, it makes it all the more difficult for him to come on parole, for him to be released early, etc. But in Qiyamah, it will be in its entirety. Inna jahannama jaza'ukum jaza'an mawfura. The famous incident of Sa'id ibn Jubair, rahimahullah, the great scholar, the great mufassir of the Quran as well. When Hajjaj ibn Yusuf had passed away, then someone seen him in a dream and asked him, how did you fare before Allah? He said, qatalani bikulli qatilin qataltuhu qatla, wa qatalani bi Sa'id ibn Jubair 70 qatla. Because of every unjust killing that I did on this earth, I was subjected to the agony of death and revived. But for claiming the life of Sa'id ibn Jubair, who was this great friend of Allah, I was subjected to the agony of death 70 times. In essence, in a nutshell, Qiyamah is a reality and it will happen. May Allah grant us all the ability to prepare for that real moment which can come to us at any time, and that when that moment comes and our death approaches us, we are ready to meet our Creator. Wa salli Allahumma wa sallim ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.